Hello, thank you for joining me today as we talk about the power of reframing language for positive well-being. It's a pleasure to be here today on speaking on a topic that I believe has the power to impact change within us and promote positive well-being. My hope is that we can explore the power of reframing language, specifically through challenging times. That being said, the practice of reframing language is one that is helpful at all times and can be incredibly powerful when things are going well, not only when things may feel like they are falling apart. My intention is that you'll be able to consider your personal narrative and the words and phrases you use when talking to yourself and others, and how incorporating positive language in your life may have the potential to lead to feeling more authentic, may promote self-kindness and self-compassion, and can nurture a safe environment for yourself and others. Something that has come up time and time again, especially through the pandemic, is the sheer amount of pressure that we feel, as well as the very limited vocabularies that we have to talk about our experience. I want to draw attention to this by looking at the example of labeling emotions. When something bad happens, we often talk about feeling sad or angry. On the other hand, when something good happens, we often talk about feeling happy or excited. When I think of these emotions, I'm transported into the movie Inside Out, which, if you haven't seen it, is a film that focuses on one young girl who is moving across the country. It looks at five main emotions that she experiences that they label the core emotions, and how they may manifest throughout a challenging time for her. These emotions are joy, sadness, fear, disgust, and anger. And when we ask people how they might be feeling, these emotions tend to be the most popular responses. The movie does a very nice job of putting a voice to emotions that we experience, but what we have to recognize is the range of emotions we have outside of these. Just even thinking about the five core emotions that they label, only one of them has a positive connotation to it. Four out of five of them are considered negative: sadness, fear, disgust, and anger. And that's not the movie's fault. Our brains are wired to think about the negative. We have to actively make changes to rewire our brains to think about the positive. Because in the past, when we think about our ancestors, we didn't have the time to process and slow down and think about, well, maybe something positive might come out of this, especially if a tiger was behind us chasing us. All we thought of was there's a threat and we have to do something in order to reduce that threat. Now we don't typically have literal tigers chasing us. We may have other threats in our life, but we are able to take a moment and think about what we can do to mitigate those. So then we have this one very lonely positive emotion, joy, which is supposed to represent every single positive emotion that we have. Feels like a lot of pressure on joy. But that might be just one emotion that we have. We may also have these other positive emotions: optimism, feeling trusting, accepted, proud, grateful, hopeful, confident, energized, and inspired. And these are just a few. And if we take a deeper dive into our other primary emotions, I wonder, do they often match the emotion that we might be experiencing? Maybe, sometimes, but there might be others and other words or emotions that might be more representative of the emotions that we are feeling. We may be able to replace our words with something that is more representative, which may in turn be a better fit for what we are feeling and take off some of the pressure and reduce the intensity of the emotions while we transition or work towards a more positive and safe space. So as I said, there may be other ways that we can describe our emotions. In Brené Brown's newest book, Atlas of the Heart, which talks about mapping meaningful connections and the language of human experiencing, she supports the thought of Ludwig Wittgenstein, who is a philosopher, that says the limits of my language mean the limits of my world. In her book, she continues with, what does it mean if the vastness of human emotion and experience can only be expressed as mad, sad, or happy? What about shame, disappointment, wonder, awe, disgust, embarrassment, despair, contentment, boredom, anxiety, stress, love, overwhelm, surprise, and all of the other emotions and experiences that define what it means to be human? Language is our portal to meaning-making, connection, healing, learning, and self-awareness. When we don't have the language to talk about what we're experiencing, our ability to make sense of what's happening and share it with others is severely limited. Language does more than just communicate emotion. It could actually shape what we're feeling. Through this excerpt, Brené Brown talks about the power of language. If we expand the words that we have and consider replacing them with something that might fit better, we could actually change our relationship with the situation. I bring forward our limited vocabulary so we can reflect on the language that we use and see where we can thicken our vocabulary a little bit more. So I'd like to bring forward two examples of ways that we can consider changing our language and discuss how it may positively impact our well-being. Of course, these are limited examples, but they are no means all of the ways that we can do this. They may also not resonate exactly with your language and your personal narrative, and that's okay. My hope is just that you may consider how replacing one word or phrase can impact us positively. I also want to emphasize that we all use these phrases and we all have the tendency to say things and may not always consider the magnitude of it, and that is all right. These are not coming from a place of shame. It's just to consider what we can do to perhaps thicken our experience. So let's just be curious about them together. So the first example that I found has come up with both my work but also in my personal life is this fun phrase, are you feeling better? So I'm going to use just a very simple illustration to discuss this and outline how this may occur. Okay, so perhaps something bad might happen, and something bad can mean anything. It could mean the end of a relationship, the loss of a job. It could mean falling down and hurting yourself. It doesn't have to have anything in particular, but something bad or considerably bad happens. Then an undetermined amount of time happens, and we may say to someone, are you feeling better? So when we say this phrase, I want us to be curious about a few things. Does it communicate to the person who is being asked this that they should be feeling better? What happens if they're not? Is there then pressure to say yes, to appease the speaker? Might they feel guilt or shame if the answer is no? What about, what are they feeling better then? This one feels like a tricky one, because when we ask this question, it's often out of love and the hope that they really are improving or in a different place than they were before. But because the question is vague, it does not really allow space to pinpoint in which areas they may be feeling better. For example, if someone has lost a loved one, they may not want to admit that they are feeling better, because what would that mean for the relationship that they had with this individual? Would that make them feel like if they don't miss them as much, that they didn't mean something to them? Will there then be negative emotions that might be transposed onto that? Or if they say yes, and they have been putting in the work to move into a more positive space, but they still realize they have more room to go or more room to grow, it can feel exhausting, which may feel discouraging. And then we consider, is there room for more than one answer? Are you feeling better? And this can, and talk about it, many ways in which we ask questions to other people, is it's a static question and really only leaves room for one answer. And for that answer to be yes. It could even be likened to leading a witness, because we've set up the question in a way in which we're hoping for one particular answer, perhaps even to reduce our own vulnerability, because it's very hard and challenging to hear that others may not be doing well, and we may not know how to place that and how to sit with that. And finally, does coping with difficult situations happen on a continuum? This one's my favorite curiosity of the bunch, because a lot of times when we hear the question, we think about, you know, somebody was sick and they were sick and now they are better. And there really only is two places on that continuum. But often there's a lot of room in between and a lot of growth. And while that's not typically what the speaker may intend of sick and then better, or not good and then good, it often is translated that way in our brains, which doesn't necessarily allow room in the middle for this solid okay between feeling bad and feeling better. And we know that coping does not work like that. It takes both time and what we do with time to be able to process our emotions. So coping instead may look a little bit more like this, a little bit messier, or even a bunch of circles intertwining as we move forward. So when thinking about possible ways to reframe this, I wonder if we consider, are there ways in which you're noticing changes in how you have been feeling? And when we think about that, are there ways in which you've noticed changes in how you're feeling today versus yesterday or last week or last month or last year? But that allows them and the person we're speaking to tangibly connect to something and see growth over time rather than thinking about how they're feeling day to day. And this may allow space to recognize progress in ways that they may not have felt before. What about, are there activities that you're able to engage with that you haven't been able to before? How do you feel in social situations? Has that changed at all? Is that same as it was a month ago for you? Or perhaps you ask at the beginning, you know, you told me you were crying a lot every day, all day, every day. Are there times during the day in which you might find that you're not crying? So it's really creating the space for these exceptions and allows you to find that possible alternative. What about, are there ways in which you might be feeling stronger? I personally like the word stronger better than better, because when I think about stronger, I think about growth. And a lot of times, even the strongest person can keep getting stronger. And somebody who may not have experience with strength may also be able to get stronger. It creates space for improvement, whether you're doing well or whether you may not be doing so well. So it might just be a way to consider how we could reframe this. Are you doing or are you feeling better? So I'm going to move on to the second example, which has to do with the language between loneliness and solitude, which has proven to be very, very important during COVID, especially during this more reintegration phase of going back into our regular life or our regular scheduled programming. So when we consider back at the beginning of the pandemic, we really didn't know what was going on. There was a lot of fear. We were told to go against our social need of being with other people and connecting. And we were told to spend a lot of time inside. For some, home was a really safe space. But even then, it led to some arguments and contention and different things going on because you have the same people all of the time. For others, home may not have been as safe. And so that posed a different challenge. And it was lonely. And for many, or for some, it can still be lonely. A lot of social anxiety has come up, and people have been struggling to reintegrate into the world. They might be feeling isolated. they also might not be feeling like they have a right to feel this way because everybody is going through it. So when thinking about loneliness as a whole, loneliness can be considered perceived social anxiety, isolation, being caught off, being without company, being cut off from others, being sad from being alone, feeling of bleakness or desolation, feeling disconnected, or even feeling shame from being alone. And at the heart of feeling lonely is the absence of meaningful social interaction. But loneliness and being alone are two very different things. And that's where solitude comes in. And that's about the quality of being alone or remote from society, enjoying one's company when alone, finding peace and healing, or even being able to trust oneself. So what's the main difference? Solitude is being alone without feeling lonely. It's without the shame of loneliness, where we're able to really trust ourselves and be present. So why should we be curious about this one? Does thinking about our alone time as a period of replenishment change our relationship with being alone? When we think about that, we may consider, well, if the answer is yes, we should honor that. And if we're able to replace being lonely with I have the space to do what I want or need right now, we may actually change our relationship with loneliness. What about thinking about how I could spend this time to focus on my needs? Is there this period where I'm able to really check in with what I need and what do I need to do? And then we can consider, am I actually feeling lonely or am I missing something else? And is there something else that I need to be doing? Now, what this does not mean is that we should label all feelings of isolation or loneliness as solitude. We don't want to sugarcoat that, and especially those hard emotions that we might be feeling. We have to allow space for the negative emotions, yet think critically about our experience and see if it actually fits. So when thinking about possible ways to reframe loneliness or solitude, some questions that might come up are, what am I learning from this time alone? What can I learn about myself? What can I learn about how I like to be supported? Am I receiving that in my life? And what are the possible benefits to having time to connect to myself? So some other examples that we're not going to go into deep detail, but I want to bring forward and maybe be curious about are these sweeping statements of I'm trying to do something in my life. I'm trying to find myself. I'm trying to get a job. I'm trying to balance whatever it is. And I just want to be curious about the word trying, of adding another layer that makes us feel like we're not doing it. And sometimes just taking away that I'm trying to, I'm finding myself, I'm adjusting, I'm balancing, takes away that pressure. We all have been guilty of saying, I should be doing this, I should be doing that, I should be farther along in life. And when we add in this should, again, similar to I'm trying to, adds in this pressure of I need to be somewhere that I am not, or I may not be. And that can introduce a whole other layer of complexity and pressure and guilt that we don't need in our lives. And in reality, it often, where does the should come from? Who is imposing this should? And finally, another one, which is my personal favorite, is perhaps changing the language of expectations versus intentions. When we have expectations of ourselves, sometimes it could feel rigid and fixed, versus if we have intentions to do something of I'd like to be at this place. Again, my theme of this slide is just reducing that pressure. So just to leave you with a final thought, I think it's very important to be able to stay authentic through this process of reframing our language. And while reframing language definitely has the ability to positively impact our lives as well as our well-being, it does have to feel authentic to you. And that may take some trial and error. It's okay if it doesn't fit at first, right? There's this basis of the phrase, fake it till you make it, and being able to put in a little bit of that work and sit in the discomfort of that. However, if it still doesn't fit after that, then that might not be the language that works for you. It does have to feel genuine. And so it's about finding phrases and language and being curious about language and saying, does this fit within my experience? If not, what might I replace it with that might be more representative and a better experience? So as I said when I started, my hope is that you will just be able to consider the language that you will use and how it may impact you negatively or positively, and what you can do to bolster and nurture the positive rather than the negative for yourself and others. So thank you for being present and sitting with me as we share this space talking about reframing language. I've provided my email address should you have any questions or want to chat more about how we can reframe language and what that may mean for you. So thank you again, and I wish you all a great day.